Yeah. Hi everyone. So I'm Prashant. I've been working with OpenStack Swift for quite some time now. So it's largely external to Gluster. So I've worked on the periphery of Gluster, but not the internals mostly. So to provide object storage using Gluster, we make use of OpenStack Swift. We depend on OpenStack Swift. So OpenStack Swift is a fully fledged distributed system, just like Ceph, just like Gluster is. People can deploy private clouds using OpenStack Swift. It's very similar to Amazon S3 service. So Swift is used by Wikipedia. So if you see all those thumbnail images in Wikipedia, they're stored on a Swift cluster. The good thing about Swift is it's very separate from the rest of the OpenStack components, so you don't need the entire OpenStack stack to use Swift. So you can just deploy a Swift-only cluster on your nodes. It's primarily used for images, media, and any kind of unstructured data. And if you need more storage, you add more nodes, you add more devices, and it can scale horizontally. But it's object storage, so you can't really mount it. So you'll have to follow the object semantics to put data in, get data back from that. But if you compare to other storage systems like Ceph, which also provides native object access, so there are other layers built on top of native object access as a block and file system, but Swift is just pure native object access. And like in file systems, you have hierarchies of directories and files. Every object storage system has its own fixed logical hierarchy. It's kind of rigid. So if you look at Amazon S3, they call it buckets, and buckets contain objects. And if you look at OpenStack Swift, it's called containers. It's got nothing to do with Docker, but it's like a bucket. So accounts contain containers, and containers have objects in them, and you cannot really nest containers. One thing that I want to point out is if you happen to Google something about Swift, do prefix OpenStack, because there's a language by Apple by the same name. So you might find results about the Swift language instead and not OpenStack Swift. So let's see what Gluster Swift is. Gluster Swift is this very thin layer that integrates Gluster with OpenStack Swift. So there's nothing fancy going on there. So it's just another application that talks to a GlusterFS fuse mount. It's largely external to Gluster. There's barely any code inside Gluster that needs special handling for Swift use case. It reuses a lot of OpenStack Swift code and kind of plugs into it. So the alternative is for us to have our own object front end. So there are pros and cons of both approaches. So to get something out really quick, this seemed the right approach back then. As you've seen here, Swift can do its own distribution and replication. So the sad thing is we just turn that off, and we just use Swift as a front end here to provide object access. So this is some of the things that object access, what it means. So when I say an object, what it has is the data, which is the content itself. And then you have data about the data, which is metadata. So some of the examples of metadata is it's very similar to the stat on the file. It says about the object size, the checksum of the object, and some user-specified key-value pairs. And the identifier is similar to the file system path. So you use the identifier to store something, and you use the same identifier to fetch it back. So to a client who is accessing object storage, all of this is abstracted. So all the client cares about and should care about is the identifier. So when he puts an object, when he stores an object, he doesn't know where it's stored. It could be on a file system as a single file. It could be on a file system as a chunk in a huge file. It could be in a database. But the client doesn't really care about where it ends up. And unlike file systems where you have FDs, the preferred protocol here is HTTP. But there are object systems that have other CLI to access as well. There are some things that makes object-based access easier for the implementers. One is there's no append, So you just upload an object. If you want to add something to it, you upload a new object. So there's no append to an existing object, but it'll allow you ranged gets. So the clients can ask for certain byte range. This will provide support for partial downloads. You can pause downloads and continue it. So that no renames only copy is a feature or attribute of Swift alone. There could be other object storage systems that allow renames, but that also makes things very simpler, because I hear DST has a whole source file to handle renames. So that is not there in Swift. But again, the logical hierarchy there is fixed. So we have containers and then objects inside them. That's pretty much about what object access looks like. Let's get into what OpenStack Swift looks like. So this is an OpenStack Swift cluster. And the proxy server is the component which talks to the external world. So all the requests go through the proxy and to the local network that's there in the backend. So just like you have layouts in DST which determine which hash range is assigned to which brick, there's something called as ring. So the ring are pre-calculated hash range to device assignments, and every node has these ring files. So whenever a client sends a request to store or retrieve an object, so the proxy server gets the hash of the identifier, and based on the hash, it will know which device and which node it can talk to. So actually, there's not one ring to rule them all. I think there's three. There's one each for account, container, and object. So basically, accounts contain the list of containers in them, and containers contain the list of objects in them. It's very simple. And this listing is stored in a SQLite DBs. So based on the hash distribution in ring, so the DBs are also replicated into multiple nodes. The default is, I think, three. And if you see those boxes, what they mean is they need not be co-located on the same node. So in a large production cluster, they'll have a few nodes dedicated to container and account servers and with SSDs in them. And the object servers will store objects as file on XFS. So if you see, there's HA at the proxy level. So if one of those object servers go down, there's other object servers, other copies where the proxy can fetch it from. But the proxy server endpoint itself, there's no HA there. So in production, what people do is they'll have multiple instances of proxies. So all of them have their same ring files. So all of them see the same cluster map. And these multiple proxies are behind usually HA proxy setup. So that'll serve load balancing and failover. This is how a plain Swift cluster would look like. Now let's see what we can do with cluster. So Swift is partly pluggable. So if you look at NFS Ganesha, they have something called as a FSAL, file system abstraction layer. So back in storage systems, just have to implement an FSAL to plug into Ganesha. It's very similar here. So if cluster needs a NFS v4 protocol support, instead of writing our own NFS v4 implementation, we just make use of Ganesha. It's very similar here. Instead of writing our own object front end, we just make use of Swift here. Just the object server part here is officially pluggable, but we kind of override some of the container and account server parts as well to get rid of the part where they talk to DB. That makes some of the cross-version compatibility tricky. So usually some versions of Gluster Swift are compatible with the exact versions of Swift. So it's written in Python, so it's easy doing that account and container overrides, but we lose compatibility across versions.
Any plans of making that pluggable upstream?
So the upstream community, I think there's only Red Hat that has shown most of the interest there, and a lot of the other companies, they're not so much into this kind of use case. So they either have their own object front end, like how Ceph does it with Rados Gateway. The downside there is whenever Swift or Amazon S3 comes up with a new feature, they'll have to re-implement it in whatever language or whatever project. So we don't have that catching up to do. So whenever Swift comes up with a new feature, we're already ready because we just plug into the backend, and most of the front sugarcoating is already there. So this is how Gluster Swift setup looks like. And we have all the processes running on the same node. The client talks to the proxy as usual. We've overrided the ring so that we map the accounts to certain Gluster volumes. So the account name is mapped to a Gluster volume. So if the client wants to upload objects to account named test, there'll be a Gluster volume named test. And we've got rid of the DBs, so there's no DBs. And all the account, container, and object server talk to the same fuse mount. And you can have multiple instances of this setup on different nodes and have it behind HA proxy for high availability. Let's look into what's inside the proxy server pipeline, the things that we get for free because we are just reusing Swift. If you're familiar with the WSGI layer in Python, you would have been familiar with middlewares. So they are very much similar to translators in the sense that they accept requests, they do some processing on it, and pass it down to the next middleware. And a lot of features in Swift are implemented as middlewares. So if you look at the pipeline there, it's very similar to your XLater graph, but there's just it's very linear. There's no you cannot have multiple children. So the request will pass from left to right, and at the end it will reach proxy server. I'll just take a few examples there. There's one called cache. What it does is, if you remember the presentation by Dan yesterday, if you have objects inside a container, usually the proxy server will only send the request directly to the object server. But how does the object server know that the container already exists, right? So we use memcache. So memcache is used to cache the metadata about the container, the existence of containers, and the account server. So whenever the proxy gets a request, it can directly route it to the right server without having to check if the container and accounts exist. There's also bulk. What it does is clients, if they have to upload thousands of files, they can just put it in a tarball and send one request. And bulk will sit on the server side, split it into individual objects, deflate it, and store it as single objects. There's also copy, which is like server-side copy. So a client can just send a HTTP request saying source and destination, and the copy happens on the back end. So this server-side copy does not incur any data download or upload to the HTTP client, but it's from a Gluster standpoint, it's still not true server-side copy because we are using a fuse mount. There's a read from the fuse mount and there's a write. Maybe we can have a GLFS CP or something to do that. So you also get version writes, which is object versioning. So there are a lot of things that you can get for free if you use Swift as a front end. There's also Tempal is a authentication mechanism. So it basically works in a way where the client sends username and password in its first request, and it gets a token back, and all subsequent requests will have that token for authentication. So that's pretty much about the proxy server pipeline. Yes, so we'll talk about middlewares, and middlewares was a really easy way to implement support for S3 API. As you know, Swift can only understand the Swift API, and there are multiple users, several users out there using S3. They have applications that can talk S3, but Swift can only talk Swift API. So you just put in the Swift 3 middleware somewhere there in the pipeline. So it will take S3 requests and convert it to a Swift request that the proxy can understand, and it can also convert response in Swift API to back to S3 API. So if you have existing S3 clients, softwares that can talk to S3 cluster, all you have to change is the URL. If it points to Amazon service, you just change the URL, and everything else should work just fine without any code changes. Let's get into how object ops are converted to FOps. So this is basically a not so performant design because all the native object storage systems, so the first entry point forwards the request to the storage node, and the storage node always talks to a local file system. But there's an additional hop here. Here the file system that Swift talks to is a networked one, so it incurs a lot of going back and forth between bricks and the cluster processes. So maybe we can make use of compound fobs here to club some of them. That could be one possible solution. People already know about port and gets. So post is when user wants to update any key value pairs associated with the object. And head request is similar to stat. So what head is supposed to return is the metadata about the object, and it will also tell people if it exists or not. So if it's a success, you get a 200 series error, or you would have seen 404s, right? So that's, yeah. So how does an object put look like? I'm just using curl. There's also a Swift client that you can use. So if you see, the test is the account name. There's a similar volume mounted at MNT cluster object test. The C1 is the container, and animals, cat, kitten is the object identifier. And you're just uploading some data in there, and that's how it gets stored in the backend. So the leaf segment there is stored as files, and all the other segments are directories. There are some limitations, we'll come to that. So the metadata are by default Python dictionaries inside, and we just serialize them into JSON. We used to use Pickle, and because of some security concerns, we had to use JSON instead. So if you just do a getafatter on the file that's there in the backend, you can read all the metadata. So this can also contain some user-specified metadata if user has specified those during upload. So you can see the content length, the MD FISM of the object, and some other information there. Yeah, so object puts. So the one guarantee that the object interface should provide is if there are multiple clients accessing or putting to the same identifier, and if there's a get request, either they get all of it or none. It should not get intermediate content or some content that's half written. So usually what applications do is they just write it to a temporary location on the same file system or device, and then they just rename. Swift recently, if it's running on Linux, it makes use of open with the OTEM file flag. So what it does is to open syscall, instead of giving a file path, you can give a directory path. And pass the OTEM file flag, what you'll get back is just an FD, but there's no corresponding entry on the file system. So you'll get a FD, you'll have the inode and data blocks allocated. And then once you write the data, fsync, and do all of those things, you can call linkat, and that is when the entry gets added to the directory. So that'll help atomicity, but that's not with cluster, that's just plain Swift. We use the temp file and rename technique in cluster. That's one trick that I think we should advertise more often. Because a lot of applications write to a temp file and then rename. So if there's a file with dot filename dot suffix, and if you rename it to filename, it'll always hash to the same node and same brick. So there's no link file and link to file. There's no movement during rebalance, etc. What will happen when there are multiple clients writing to the same identifier, same object location? So the behavior here is known. Which is last write wins. So the bad thing there is both the clients get a success response, but the one that prevails on the disk is the last write. So how do clients know if the object that they wrote is the one that they're getting back? So that's why we have etag. So every response has an etag. If the client makes note of the etag, the next time it does a get, if it gets a different etag, somebody else has written to the same object location. So there's also object listing. So just like you can have readdir, you can send gets on the container, which internally does something similar to ls minus r, and in some cases ls minus lr, which is terribly slow. But the client is explicitly asking for the list of the objects, their sizes, and also the e-tag. And the e-tags are stored in getExcetera, so it incurs a lot of getExcetera calls in there. This again is a trade-off between choosing to use the DBs and not use the DBs. Yeah, that's a trade-off as of now. Even if we somehow manage to deploy this on DBs, the main thing that people get of Gluster Swift is they can put objects in and access it as files or views, NFS. They can put files in and access it as object. But we might break support for that if we introduce DBs again at the expense of faster listings. It'll be another hard problem to keep the DB consistent with the actual file system view. That's why we're not doing that. So there's some things that we cannot support due to performance reasons. So one of that is when someone sends a GET request on the container, the metadata should accurately reflect the exact object count and the bytes used by that container. In Swift, it's pretty simple because they just read it from a DB. But in Gluster Swift, we'll have to do a crawl to fetch that, so we usually avoid that. The headers are they need to go first in the protocol rules, so you cannot crawl first, calculate, and then set the header back. So you have to send the header first and then do the crawling part. So this is one thing that we cannot support. The other one is there are some things that are legal in Swift API. So as we map the object URL path directly to the file system as is, so there are some restrictions. So I create a object animals/cat. Now cat is a file and animals is a directory. In just Swift, it's legal to create animals/cat/kitten because in a Swift-only cluster, it uses the hash of the object URL to figure out the backend file system path. So that's perfectly legal in a plain Swift cluster, but not so much in Gluster Swift. You'll get an error back if you try something like that. So that's pretty much it. And there are some ideas that that we can use. So one is zero copy. So the copy request can be offloaded to the brick side. The other one is it still uses views. We can use the Python bindings. Swift has been rewritten in Go for performance reasons, and Rackspace has seen some very promising results, huge improvements. So we could just use that. And Kaushal already has Go bindings for LibGef API. And the ultimate goal would be to have native object inside cluster, which is something similar to GLFS put, GLFS get. You give the name, data, and the metadata, and it goes off in a single call. It could be a new FOP, or it could use the compound FOP framework internally. Yeah, that's about it. Yeah. Questions?
So you were saying that the number of entries in the container, is it? It's a bit difficult. Did you get a chance to use inode quotas, which actually counts the number of objects inside the directory?
We've thought about it, but we'll need to set quota for every container. Whenever a container is created, we'll have to do the mapping, but we've thought about it. But you still may not get the bytes used as accurately. So you'll still have to deviate from the container X bytes containers used. So when they were developing the object count, so we had requested them to have a separate count for directory and files themselves. So what we get back is a file count, but so if you see the animals/cat, so there can be directory objects. So you'll get an overall count of directories and objects, but you can't really know which of them constitute an entire object, right? So.
Other questions?
To add to the Pranit's question and your answer, so if you restrict the write only from the Swift gateway or Swift proxy, so also and not allowing write from any other fuse client also. Because the use case is different, it's object store. So only you can enable the read access from other other clients. So if you restrict only to Swift, then you can maintain that file count, right? File
count.
Even the directory listing you can maintain. So
I mean, if there's no access from other protocols, we could as well use the DB, right? So we don't even have to do the crawling. We can also use the DB. So there's a project called Swift on File. The difference between Swift on File and Cluster Swift is Swift on File is more suited where the deployment already has a Swift cluster and they just want to add a cluster to the existing Swift cluster. So in that case, just the object server part is plugged in and the Swift DBs will continue to use as they are. So that's another project, Swift on File. So
okay.
That's pretty much
thank
it.
You.
Thank you.
So there's coffee that's showing up in the back there.